Hello, assassins and anti-heroes. My name is TB's Guy, and Riot's collaboration with Marvel Comics has produced another completed comic run. Zed has finally been finished with the sixth issue going up on the website a couple of days ago now, and boy howdy, doesn't that thing have a twist at the end? It sure does have a twist. That's a twisty twist, and I think we do need to talk about it. However, I haven't talked about this said comic at all while it was being published, because I kind of tried to do that with the Ash comic, and I found that it was a really awkward way to try and talk about it, especially in terms of the story, where you kind of need the whole arc of the thing before I felt like I was comfortable really talking about it. So now, the whole thing is out, and we're gonna tackle the entirety of the goddamn thing in one video. So strap yourselves in, folks. This is probably gonna be a long one. So, we're going to tackle this the same way that I sometimes tackle lore on the League of Legends Universe website, which is going to go through it. We're going to go through it page by page, issue by issue, and whenever I have something that I find remarkable in the comic that I want to remark upon, then I'll stop and remark on it, which is why this video is going to be quite long. If you just want to hear me talk about the twist at the end of the comic, the big twist, which is definitely going to get spoiled in this video, just so you know, then I'm going to put a timestamp on screen right now, and you can head on over there to get your thoughts on that stuff. If you want to hear me nitpick the entirety of this comic, though, stick around. And I'm not just going to nitpick. It's not just going to be criticism. I have a lot of praise for this comic as well. It does a lot of really cool, interesting things that I really like, and then it does some things that I have, well, a different opinion on. So, the thing we're going to start with first is the credits on this particular comic. I'm a comic artist myself. It's a little bit close to my heart. So the writer of this particular piece is Odin Austin Schaefer, who is a senior narrative designer, I believe, at Riot Games. So the writer is in-house, and then I would have to imagine that it's Marvel who has supplied, well, all the artists and all the publishing support. So the penciler is Edgar Salazar, the Lorenzo Ruggiero is the inker, Chris O'Halloran is the colorist, the letterer is John Rochelle of Comic Craft, presumably an independent. Edgar Salazar and Andres Mosa provided the cover, and the assistant editor at Marvel is Martin Biro, with the editor at Marvel being Mark Bazzo. And then we have Marvel Publishing themselves, who I won't go through them entirely, but if you're into comics, you'll recognize names like Joe Quesada and C.B. Cybulski, and Cybulski perhaps for less than flattering reasons you can look up on your own. Let's start with the beginning. This is a comic that's very much in the Western comic art tradition. And like, just in terms of the art style, you can tell from looking at especially this dude's face, like that stuff right there is pure. Yeah, that's pure Marvel comic. That's very much a Marvel comic superhero face with the screwed up eyes and the shouting with the teeth out for no discernible reason. Yeah, that's it. And I'm gonna have a lot of nitpicks with that, which is not specifically like a thing against any of the artists who worked on the thing, but it's an art style that I have, like, I have a very long history with it. I have read a hell of a lot of comics in my time, and there's certain tropes in Western comic art that I've just grown tired of, and that face right there, I'm afraid to say, is one of them. But, oh, by the way, one thing I want to note on. Gorgeous, gorgeous color work on Jin's mask, and lovely work on, like, something that would have been very easy to do with Jin's mask, for example, was to have it be too symmetrical, which, of course, Jin himself would hate, but also just in terms of, like, when you're constructing a relatively complicated geometric shape like that one, pretty easy to just go, okay, let's just do a bunch of rulers and make it look real straight. This looks hand-carved, and that's partly due to the quality of the pencils and the inks that are doing a great job of providing a lot of contour and texture around the mask itself and really using the shadow to highlight its shapes and functionality, and partly down to the colorist, who has a great sense, especially in this shot, of just how to make the mask appear both, like, really menacing and kind of scary, and give it that kind of horror movie aesthetic feeling vibe a little bit, where it's like, there's like a little bit too much detail almost, somehow it feels a little bit too real, especially compared to the rest of the artwork, and that's an intentional artistic choice that makes this thing seem more creepy. It's something that Scott McCloud has discussed extensively, that, like, the more detail, the more realistic rendering you add to an object, especially if that realistic rendering is incongruous with the rest of the universe, which is much more in this sort of cartoony Western superhero comic style, it gives it an uncanny feeling, which is really effective to make something look intimidating or frightening or dangerous, which is working very well for Jin's mask right here. Anyway, getting into the thing itself, the comic, it's about Zed, and the comic itself, in terms of its story conceit, is about Zed. It's about expanding on his character, his motivations, who he is, why he does what he does, how he thinks about his betrayal of Shen and the Kingku Order, and so on and so forth. And so, it is relatively appropriate that we begin the story with Zed standing at, and I'm gonna mispronounce Zed's name many, many times over the course of that, because I'm gonna say Zed. Instead of saying Zed, which is the voiced alveolar fricative, I'm going to use the unvoiced alveolar fricative, also known as the S sound, and say said. And that's because I'm Danish. That's part of my Danish foreign accent. So Zed is standing at the foot of a statue of his old master, a glorification, a deification of his master, which is an image that's going to come back again a little bit later in the story, a lot bit later, actually. But remember that Zed begins the story standing at the foot of a statue of his master, reified and deified as a great defender of Ionia, slayer of demons, hero of the land, and he's literally standing in the statue's shadow. Appropriate for Zed, because Zed is a shadow, and appropriate for how he feels about this particular man at this point. A student who betrays his master is like a worm, which they could just have said worm instead of worm. Worm sound, it's one of those little things that I've talked about when I talk about lore many times before. Like, sometimes I get annoyed when it's like, you have a perfectly good, perfectly ordinary English word, and then you have to invent some magical version of it. And I don't know, worm is also a thing in English, but like, he's not like a worm, he's not like a ancient legendary creature, he's like a worm who crawls through the earth. Anyway, slight nitpick from my part. So, one more nitpick. Zed is not on model a lot in this comic, I feel like. Zed's construction of his face seems to kind of shift rather randomly from panel to panel. Like, to me, this doesn't look like the same face as this or that. And it's not like, it's not extreme, it's not that much, but there is like an inconsistency, especially with Zed and with other characters staying on model from panel to panel, that it's not a big deal, but it bothers me. So basically, we begin the story with Zed being an assassin. He's out to murder a guy, and rather than Zed just showing up in the shadows and going nothing personnel kid and stabbing the dude in the back, he has an honorable fair fight with him, as it were. And why does he do that? Well, because Zed is an honorable man. He's like, I will fight Master Alton alone.
Yes, Master.
But I warmed up! Kane is very upset that he doesn't get to murder anybody right now. And Zed has a fair fight with him because he's honorable and because he was his master's nephew who still respects his master, blah, blah, blah. Zed has an honor complex. That's going to come up a lot in this story. So we have this cool dude who floats around and has magic spears that also float around and a big set of armor that's not going to help him at all. And we get into the first action scene. And this is, for my money, the action is some of the weaker stuff oftentimes in this particular comic. We'll get into other nitpicks as well, but one of my major criticisms is the action panels. Like this one, for example. You can see the basic principles of there. We've got the speed lines getting some speed and dynamism to the panel. We've got like spears flying in every which direction. We've got the character charging straight at the screen. Except we've also got a bit of a case of fly swatting here. And fly swatting is a term that I don't know how widely it's used, but it's something one of my art teachers used with me, where when you trying to draw something that feels three-dimensional and like it exists in three dimensions, you accidentally end up flattening it out on the page instead of really using the depth of the space to heighten the depth of the action. And that's happening here, because notice, like, what's supposed to be happening here is that this guy's flying at us. Like, he's going directly at the viewer. It's supposed to be a moment of power of him going, like, Super Saiyan and charging at the enemy, like, "Rah! After I kill you!" It's supposed to have power and impact, and he's supposed to look very threatening. But look at what all the spears are doing. All the spears, none of them are flying at us, the viewer. They're all flying off to the side a little bit. He is not even really, his spear isn't really pointing at us, it's pointing downwards. He is not really distorted into the space. Like, you can see the idea is that he's leaning forward and like flying forward fast, but his whole body is on screen. Like, he's not really leaning in front of himself very much. He's not distorted into the space. Like, you could really oversize the thing that's coming towards us and undersize the parts of the body that is further back so that we deepen the space and give more of a sense of speed. And the thing I can't help but think is that if this panel was in, like, Naruto or One Punch Man or something like that, if they wanted to draw a pose like that, one of the instant things that those artists would do is that they would have these spears not just flying off the sides of the panel here, they would have them poking, like pointing and poking directly at the viewer, really distorted and exaggerated perspective, with the spears looking threatening rather than looking like at the moment they kind of just look like they're bursting out of him and flying to the sides, rather than flying forward. And this is something I'm probably going to bring up like a bunch of times when it comes to the action in this thing, is that there's some fly swatting going on. There are times when it's trying for really high impact, and I just, the line work just doesn't get me there. It just doesn't. Like, it feels too flat. It feels too static. And I'd also say, like, the speed lines here could be heightened way, way, way. Like, you could do so much more with the speed lines to really communicate the power and impact. You could put speed lines on the character themselves because they're the ones who are moving fast rather than just in the environment. Things like that. Now, what you'll notice from my criticism here is that a lot of the criticism I'm making here is also, like, it's because I have a problem with the Western comics style and tradition. I really like the higher impact action frames and the higher impact action art tradition in Eastern comics, especially in manga. And that is informing my criticism. Like, so if you have a thing like, but I really like the Western comic style, I really like the way that they do it, that's like, fair enough. My criticism is informed by a different opinion. And it's the same thing here. Like, he's throwing a spear at Zed. It's supposed to be this big threatening thing that Zed dodges at the last second. Why not, again, just really distort the perspective here? Really go hard on making the spear feel like it's coming straight at us. So that when Zed dodges it, it feels more impactful rather than he's just like... Because look at the pose here. Like, there's no speed lines on his arm. He's just going, ha! And then the spear is flying forward, I guess. And then the spear lands. And the thing I would kind of have liked here is, for example, if, like, Zed transforms into a shadow, what if the spear went through the shadow, punched a hole in the shadow, and we get to see that Zed is dodging, like, right at the last second? That would have been cool. Some positives. I really like these shadow effects. Like, they work really well. They sort of bridge the gap halfway between a cloud, like, halfway between smoke and ink, that I really like. I really like that it's using that... it's adding that sense of sort of almost goopy, like slimy weight to the textures of the shadows, which is something that's going to come up later, is that this shadow magic here, it's not just smoke, it's almost like a liquid, which is really cool. Here again, I feel like there's very unclear action here, because we've got two shurikens flying at the master here, at Master Althan, right? Who threw those shurikens? Like, where did they come from? Did they ace this hand here and Zed threw that one at him? But then how did he throw that one going curving that way with this hand? And this is where I would have liked to see some speed lines or some movement lines on Zed himself to show, hey, he flicked this thing at him. A little impact frame showing the point of where Zed threw them from, or if his shadows threw them, or what exactly is going on. I would also like... Here, in terms of the coloring, I feel like you could have, like, darkened the color around the edges and used, like, a gradient and then had light, bright light behind Master Althan himself to highlight him as the center of the image, because he's the one that all the images are all the lines are pointing at, and it's him and Zed who are, like, it's the dynamic between them that's the focus of the image. Anyway, bunch of stuff like that. Here, again, I really dig the smoke and the debris and the dust in this panel right here. A lot of good smoke and debris effects here. I don't dig this. So I can see the idea here. I can see the idea is that he has just thrown a spear, like he's still in the same pose that he has up here, and then Zed teleports behind him and kills him, right? Before he has time to react. He doesn't have time to move, he doesn't have time to do anything. So what the artist has done here is they have copy-pasted the art from one panel to another and then added Zed in the other one. Now, copy-pasting is a completely valid artistic technique. Sometimes it makes sense. If you want to show that a character has not moved a single muscle from one panel to another, copy-pasting can be a very good idea. In this instance, I would have, like, at least I would have liked to see the smoke move or change, like, more substantially than than it does. And by the way, it's not literally copy-pasted. You can tell there are little differences in the details of the artwork, but it's copy-pasted in the sense of, like, holding on to exactly the same pose, exactly the same state of the world. But I would have liked just a little bit of change from panel to panel where Olthen, like, barely looks back and is surprised that Zed is showing up. Something along those lines would have worked better for me particularly. And also, one of the reasons why it doesn't work is that he's in this... He says, "Let's see what Master Kusho taught you." And then he throws his spears. And then, "Fool, I am more than a Kinku." And then he's still in the same pose while he says, "Shadow magic doesn't make you better than Kusho." What? He has spoken, there's been this much dialogue between here and here, and yet he's still in exactly the same pose. He hasn't moved a muscle. Narratively, for me, in terms of the time of the time compression of what's going on, that doesn't work for me. And sort of the nadir here, for me, is this panel here, which again, this is supposed to be the maximum impact, like the most like the most shocking, the most affecting panel of the whole fight when Zed lands the death blow, the literal death blow. That's literally the technique he's using. And here again, this seems very, very flat, doesn't it? Like, we have this character over, like, one shadow over here, the other shadow over there, and Zed, rather than behind him, which is where he appears behind him, and now all of a sudden he's above him and stabbing him from the front? So, like, why didn't he stab him through the back and into the... It's really weird that they will all... they flattened the image out so much instead of, like, having this shadow in front of him and this shadow, like, back behind him to the side and then Zed, like, right behind him and focusing on the blade coming out of the man's chest instead. And they're trying to do a payoff here. You can see these shurikens that are showing up and also crashing into poor Master Olthen. These will be the shurikens that were put into the air at this point, right? 1, 2, 3. And then they show up here. 1, 2, and 3. But also, I don't get any sense of movement from them at all. Like, has this one been stuck in his chest for a while? Or did it just land there? Is this one flying in from the side? Where is its speed lines? Where is its movement lines? And what's this one doing? This one looks more like it's flying away from him than towards him, to my eyes, because I don't have any visual indication of where they're going or how they're moving. Similarly, with the shadows, like, we have this sense of a circle of shadow going on here. But does that mean this shadow is moving downwards? Because that's what this smoke trail implies, is that it's moving downwards. But then if that one's moving downwards and kind of sliding into him there, then this one's coming in from the side back there and it doesn't have a smoke trail. And then Zed doesn't have... Like, there's a lot of lack of clarity, in my opinion, about the movements of what happens in the action scenes in this comic. So, this is a demonstration of a lot of the criticisms I have, so I'm going to try and not go off for 10 minutes about every single fight scene in the comic, or we'll be here for 10 days. Other little nitpicks, like poses like this one, it's supposed to be Zed lands, or Zed lands, I'm going to try and pronounce it correctly, and then he's like... cool guys don't look at explosions and walking forward, but this is again a very flat, like, I have trouble even seeing that he's supposed to be moving forward here. Like, he's sort of vaguely half lifting his foot, but his arms are like stiff down by his side as though he's like trying to flex, or he's got something really cold stuck between his butt cheeks. Like, I don't know, it just doesn't work for me on a lot of levels. This panel though, quite good. I really like the composition here of like having the spear literally be a grave marker for Olthen, and then having them walk away and having them highlighted in like colder bluish colors where the rest of the environment is very warm, yellow, red, that kind of thing. Very effective, works really well. I also love, like, the character design on this demon is just, yes, that is a spirit, I guess. That's a really cool ass character design for a demon. Like, Demogorgon face with like the scrolls coming out and the tentacles off the... Oh, that's a nice little nightmare fuel bastard right there. And it also, it's a good way to introduce Set as a... to do Shen, rather, as a badass, that the first thing he does in the comic is kick this guy's ass like he's frickin' nothing. Splat! And here's a better action panel, because here I feel like there's a depth to the space. Where maybe I would have liked more of a trail on the sword, like to really, again, emphasize that it's swinging into our space and then receding back behind Shen, but this works really well with the effects, with like Shen literally cutting a hole through this demon That has a lot more power and impact. And part of the reason why is because the demon is allowed to be much more in our space, much closer to us. So there's much more of a sense of depth in the image. I think that works really, really well. Let's see. Outside of that, nice horses. Horses are really hard to draw. They do a really good job in this comic. That's something I kind of want to call out, because, like, if you've ever tried to draw a horse, boy howdy, it's like, that shit ain't easy. So congratulations to the artists on doing a good job of managing it. I should also compliment the colorist. There's excellent use of color for staging in this comic, because, like, we have this introductory scene. This is clearly happening, like, at twilight or at sundown. Oranges, reds, pinks, purples, just dominating the scene. And at the end of the scene, it's finally starting to get a little darker, which means some of the characters are getting really dark. Then we move on to Shen's location, and it's kind of the same light a little bit, but this is much more in, like, in greenery, a little bit more neutral, rather than being sort of completely flooded in color the same way that Zed's scene was. So even through the color choices, we're getting a different staging. We're seeing that we're in different locations because the light is different. Which, again, moving on to the next scene, hey, we have this dark Quoll chat tavern in the outskirts of Thonks. It really makes you Thonks. In the Xuan Highlands. And again, the staging and the coloring and the use of light and shadow gives us a perfect sense of, hey, this is a completely different place. Well done, Mr. Colorist. Let's see. Anything else in the first issue that's particular? Well, sometimes, like, I feel like this is again less... This is more of one of my problems with Western comics tradition. Why are none of their mouths open when they talk? They just stare at... I don't get that. In Western comics tradition, I don't understand why it is that so many times when characters speak, they're like close mouths for some reason when so much of the expression of a character comes out through speech. Like, that was... That's one of the best ways to show what kind of person that character is how they talk. So... That just bothers me personally, as I don't like characters whose mouths are closed when they're supposed to be talking in the panel. Just bothers me. It's also, this is more a question of rendering, but I feel like Kane consistently looks too old. Like, he's supposed to be a kid, right? Like, Zed, it makes sense to have a lot of rendering, a lot of lines on his face. His age also seems to fluctuate rather rapidly from panel to panel, though. But for him, it makes more sense. But for Kane, he's like, look at him in game. He's a smooth-faced little anime pretty boy. That's kind of his whole deal, is that he's an anime pretty boy who turns into a demon, a monster. That's the whole fantasy. And then in this comic, like, it's like sometimes he just looks like he's 40 in his face, and I don't understand why. Because that's not a kid. Like, plenty of characters don't have all of that nonsense going on, so I don't fully understand why that is. Again, compliments on the shadow effects. This is a very cool way to show the scariness of shadow magic on this character. Like, with the bright white eyes and the thing, him literally almost turning into a demon. Also, a good way to literalize the thing of, like, hey, maybe there's a reason this is forbidden magic. Maybe, in fact, that magic can make people do really bad things. Gee, I wonder if that's gonna come up later in the story at all. This is supposed to be Zed as a kid. He's a child. Why does he look like he's 35? Why? There's too much rendering in the face. Like, this is where I'd really... Like, Zed and Ionia and Kane and the ninjas and stuff like that has always been much more of an anime bullshit-inspired thing. At least in my opinion. So having the Western comic tradition used to render these characters, it just bothers me. This is a petty complaint. It's not a real criticism, really. It's just... it's just me. Here again... this is so flat. Like... This is so flat. And a lot of it feels like the artist is really unwilling to put things in front of other things. Like, they're really unwilling to block parts of their artwork with other parts of their artwork, because the thing I would have done here, and I'm not nearly as technically an accomplished artist as the artist behind this thing is, but what I would have done here is I would have had that cliff extend up over and cover up the landscape here to really, like, to give more depth to the image. I wouldn't have tried to show that there's a path leading down, like, because I don't know what the hell the depth of this image is supposed to be. I can't tell the sense of scale because this doesn't look like it's that far away from that because of the path that isn't really clearly delineated in the image. And then there's this building right here, which is about the same size as that one over there, despite being on top of a cliff miles away above a waterfall. So is that a huge building, or is that one tiny? And relative to the, like, there's a lot of, there are times when the perspective and the scale of the images just does not work for me. Here, for example, like, what's the size of that building relative to the people who are supposed to live in it? Is that a tower, or is that just like, eh? And again, a relatively petty complaint. Something I do like in this image, the use of yellow on Jin's victim. He's the golden demon, after all. So, hey, that's very efficient. I do like the differentiation between the characters, like, who are shaded out in blue, and then the victims themselves highlighted. Like, it's not realistic at all, but it's not supposed to be. It shows the feeling of the scene, and it does that really effectively. I also like the debris effects on the burned buildings and stuff like that, where you can really see the charring and the breaking of the buildings. That's really well realized, and that's I think that's done with ink brush, probably, unless it's done digitally, who knows. Either way, all right, so here we have one of the pivotal scenes of the entire story, like one of the most important scenes for Zed's character as a whole. This is when he's confronted with the horrors of what Jin can do, and when he learns one of the most important lessons that he'll ever learn as a person. The idea here is that all of these images together are crashing into Zed's mind. Like, this he's experiencing all of this all at once, and it's a traumatic experience. It's overwhelming. It's way too much. And it's like, I would have gone harder then. Like, I would have gone way harder on the horror and the, like, and it goes pretty hard. I don't know where they are in terms of, like, ratings. Like, if they only can go up to, like, an NC-17 rating, however the hell that works. That's probably part of the reason. But I would have made the horror more explicit, especially in Zed's face, which is all of a sudden rendered very smooth. Like, compared to what he looks like up here, where there's plenty of lines all over the boy's face, here, all of a sudden, he looks smooth and boyish and young. And that might be an intentional thing, that he's supposed to look like a child in this moment because he feels like a powerless child. I can kind of see that. But the result is that his expression looks completely blank rather than horrified. He just looks like, oh, wow, that's weird, more than, oh god, this is the worst thing I've ever experienced in my life. Which is where I would have pushed it more, I think. Anyway, this is one of the most important moments of Zed's life, and I like the use of the golden light here. I like the use of the sunbeams, like, cutting through the image, also being associated with the healing magic that Zed is trying to use on the dying man here. Again, I would have liked to push the expressions a little bit more, because here's where Zed is forced to accept that he can't save everyone, and sometimes one person dying is better than three people dying. Which is what Kusho says to him, which is the most important lesson that he learns. This is definitely one of the better scenes in the comic. I think a lot of care was put into this bit especially, because it feels like, when you're reading it, yes, I have my criticisms, but it feels like you get the feeling of the horror that Zed is going through. And here's where I really like the over-rendered face of Kusho, because this is a man who's tired, who's pushed to the edge. There's something slightly grotesque about his mouth, and there's supposed to be. Like, this is supposed to be not nice at all. And the art is doing a good job of emphasizing that, I think. This is also where Kusho chooses Zed as the successor for the Kinku Order. Another important thing, that's, I believe, also a retcon. Like, I believe originally Zed's grudge was that he wasn't chosen as the successor. But that's, no, he was chosen as the successor, but that's, I think that's like two retcons ago. Zed has had a lot of changes to his story, and I'm not really clear on which came in what order. Yeah, again, push the expressions harder would be my criticism, but other than that, it works perfectly fine. And here, here's something clever. Like, Zed has seen this kind of, they've stumbled on a murder scene, and Zed has seen the kind of murder that has been done here before, so it doesn't affect him. He's highlighted in gold, because he's not really, like, because he's more familiar with the golden demon, and also to make him stand apart from Kane and the dude in the background who's not important because he's gonna die. But it, again, here's where I really feel like the expressions of the other characters should have been pushed much harder. Like, to make the horror really shine on their faces, to highlight just how unaffected Zed is by it because he has seen it before. To highlight how fucked up it is that Zed has had to see that shit before. Anyway, Jin is introduced in this panel, and it's a good introduction. On my first look at this panel, I was like, oh, I don't like that, actually, because what the hell are his proportions? He looks all wrong. But then, having a think about it, no, wait, actually, I like that. I like that Jin looks really lanky and skinny, but then there's that big beefy mask on his face that makes him look like he's got a huge head. And his legs are like, so much of his anatomy is hidden underneath his coat that it becomes hard to parse what exactly is going on. And it would be easy to say, oh, that's just bad artwork, but it's not. I don't think it is. I think this is intentional. Like, this is an intentional use of his physicality to show that this is a sick, twisted sociopath who likes to murder people and who has a twisted idea of what beauty is. Like, showing him with misshapen proportions without showing him as being like having birth defects or being deformed as such is a good way to do that. And that was issue one. That only took us half an hour. We'll move a little bit faster through the next ones because a lot of my criticisms I've already framed. For example, this one, same as my criticism of the battle with Master Althan, more depth in this space. Like, I really wish there would be more depth in this. Like, and I say depth not in terms of being deep emotionally, but depth as in depth of field, depth of space. Like, that it feels a lot more like Zed is closer to the camera and Jin is Jin's body perhaps is further away, but with the gun more emphasized, something along those lines. But again, that's a stylistic criticism in part also of the Western comics tradition, which in my opinion at least does that more often. Again, great use of color in the space, like with the blue highlighting the characters, ironically, despite being more of a subdued color, against like the bright, almost sheer white, icy blue of the victims, as well as the dark green of the grass. And then this poor idiot dies. This panel right here, this is good as hell. Like this, oh, this is again where here there's so much rendering on each feather and on the flowers or the nautiluses or whatever the hell they are, the things that burst out of him and the flower. And that works. Like, that works like gangbusters because it makes the whole thing feel so much more fucking horrifying when stuff starts bursting out of people's bodies. Like, it's awful. It's terrifying. And that works really, really well. I also like this panel a lot. Like, I like the use of sheer yellow against the glow of the gun to really highlight the power of the thing that he's shooting at them. Works really well. I wish, again, here, there's some fly swatting going on, I feel like, where everything feels like it's kind of flat and on the same level in the image, where it's supposed to be that Zed is running off to this direction, while Kane and the other dudes are dodging behind the buildings here. I love the use of color. Like, I like that Jin's magic is so, like, it's so gaudy and colorful and excessive in ways that make it stand out and feel unnatural and terrifying against what's going on. Now, I should comment on the writing as well at some point, I feel like. The first comic was more of a setup thing. It sort of sets up that, hey, Jin is back, and also Zed is doing random assassination missions for the Navori Brotherhood because of reasons. Here, we start to get into the intrigue. And again, Kane looks like he's 45, and I don't understand why. But here we start to get into more of the intrigue, where it turns out that Jin's gun is a new thing that Zed hasn't seen before. He's learned to put magic in a foreigner's weapon. Good revelation that surprises us, because it also means that Zed is off balance. He doesn't know what Jin's capabilities are with that particular weapon. This panel is really good. But the writing, it is better to feel calm. If you cannot do that, then you must run towards your fear. Because this shows us that Zed, in all that he does, is constantly remembering Kusho's lessons. Like, if the original idea of Zed was that he was a bitter student who was like, I was denied my birthright by my master who didn't recognize my power and potential. This is a different character. This is someone who remembers those lessons with respect and with reverence and who puts them into practice in what he does. And I really, again, love the inky quality of the shadows as they spill around. Here's a really cool transition. Zed is being forced into his own memories by the sight of what Jin is leading him towards. So crack, boom. So we have like one sound effect begins in the present, another sound effect begins in the past. Then we have panels splitting in time. The gutters between panels are also gutters in time. Using the format of the comic as a thing, like the format of the comic book to show a transition in time. That's very cleverly done. I really like that. Here is like where, like, I think it's cool that Jin gets the drop on him. That's fine, but the thing that bothers me about this panel is that I have no sense at all where Jin got the drop on him from. I think it's supposed to be from here because there's a little splash as though Jin had leapt from there. But again, there's a lack of clarity of movement. There's a lack of like movement lines, speed lines, anything that could have told me where the hell Jin came from. And I don't think the point of this panel is to show that Jin comes out of nowhere, like completely impossible to spot. So, I don't know. I like Jin's body language. His body language in the dialogue scenes that he gets is good, because he has this theatrical quality about him. Like, he has this, "Oh, come, come, you really do want to look. Yevnai is her name, isn't it? Forbidden love, I sent Yevnai a note asking her to meet you here at sundown. Don't shout or I will have to kill her sooner than intended." Like, with the pointing and the flamboyancy, that's good. I like that. I like the serial killer, like, "Tell me, what does your little amulet do?" Like that. I love the body language on Jin. The body language is very good. I also like here the expressions are being pushed a lot more with Zed, well, pretending to beg Jin for the life of his beloved. And here, this is Shen bursting through the wall just by sheer brutish power, smashing all of Jin's plans to pieces. And again, the space feels flat. Like, it doesn't, I don't know what these speed lines around him there are supposed to be. I don't know. He's supposed to be bursting through the wall, right? So why is he pointing his arm this way instead of into the image? Again, the fly swatting just kills the action a little bit for me. Anyway, Jin gets one over on Zed, has set up and timed this assassination perfectly. Zed fails to stop any of it because he's obsessed with chasing Jin rather than trying to save the civilians. And cool guys don't look at explosions, but this time he's not a cool guy, he's an extremely angry and upset guy. Boom. But this is also, again, a change in Zed's character that he actually cares quite a lot about innocents dying. In fact, innocents dying is one of the most terrible things to him. It's one of the things that he abhors the most. It's one of the reasons why he became the Master of Shadows, which again feels like a substantial change to the character from Mr. "I'm upset because my master didn't choose me to be the leader of the orders. I'm gonna murder him and start an evil revolution of evil ninja cults." Mwah! Feels like a different version of the guy, which is good. Like, I don't mind that they're retconning him at all. I think they're retconning him in very good ways, except for, well, we'll get to that. Again, characters talking with their mouths closed. It's like, just let them emote, man. Just let them say a word with their face or something. Like, especially here, like, Shen is talking so much. He's saying so many things, like, "Six demons are more important. Shen is just a man. Akali, all my father ever..." How are you saying all that through closed lips, my friend? And, like, sometimes there's a reason to have a character have their mouth closed in a dialogue panel, by the way. If you want to show that they're, like, clenching their teeth or really, like, screwing up their face so they're being, like, angry or something. Like, if there is some kind of visual gesture that you can make with a face that accentuates what the character is saying, sure. And that's, I guess, kind of happening here with, like, this protruding bottom lip, and it feels like Shen is really kind of gritting his teeth a little bit, I suppose. But it's so much words! And no mouth doing the moving thing. It's, Anyway, Zed goes to see Yevnai, his former lady love that Jin tried to murder right in front of him. And here's some of what this comic does really well in the writing. Something I really, really like is that it gives us a lot of insight into the kind of person Zed is, the kind of character that informs the decisions that he makes. "The last time I saw you, the night before you left the Kinku Order, I owe you an apology for my behavior. I allowed my emotions to overcome me. No, I don't think I will take your apology. If you had kissed me because you wanted me, I think I might have even liked that, but you kissed me because you were looking for a reason to leave. Because even then, you were looking to destroy everything." Like, first of all, solid own. second of all, nice insight into the character that on the night when Zed left the Kinku Order, like, he went to her and kissed her, but he didn't do it because he loved her, but because he was looking for a reason to leave, because he was looking for an excuse to do what he wanted to do, which is important. That's going to come up later, but that's being set up here that that's part of Zed's character. Anyway, I first mistook this girl for Karma when I saw her in the panels because of the purple coloring and the, like, her general bearing with black hair and all that, which was funny, and it took me a second to realize, hang on, no, wait, that wouldn't make even a little bit of sense at all. Anyway, Zed has a tendency to react with violence when he doesn't get what he wants. Another solid bit of characterization, and she doesn't give a shit. I like that about her. That's good characterization of her. Is like, Zed is like, "Mah, you will tell me where Shen is, mah!" Like, he has a tantrum, and she's just like, "That was my favorite teapot, asshole." She doesn't react to that at all. It gives you a good insight into their relationship as well, is that she knows him well enough that she knows it's bluster and it's empty posturing and it's just an angry man being angry. And he wouldn't have the courage or the cruelty to actually follow through with it for real. It was always this way with Yevnai. Shen was powerless before her. I was too, and for the same reason. So, Zed is determined to get Shen's help in trying to track down Jin because Jin is an asshole and Zed hates him. And Yevnai won't help him, because of, obviously. But again, if you go to see Shen, he will kill you, Uzan. And with all that you took from him, he deserves that vengeance. I know. Another good bit of insight into Zed's character is that he hates himself. Like, he really hates himself. He's not very fond of who he has become at all. He has done it because he thinks it's necessary, but he's also like, yeah, I was kind of a dick to Shen, and he probably deserves to drive a sword through my heart. Because I'm a dick. I'm an asshole. Which, again, is a good insight into the character, is that there is that element of both self-insight. Like, he understands that Shen probably has a right to want to take revenge on him, and also self-hatred, which is a great character motivation, by the way. Like, I like characters who are motivated to some degree by self-hatred. First of all, because relatable. Second of all, because it often leads them to do the kinds of things that set interesting stories into motion, i.e. behave irrationally and do stupid shit that puts them in danger, which is certainly the kind of thing that Zed ends up doing. And here, puppets dancing on a string. Gee, I wonder if that is a metaphor for what is happening in the story. It's a little bit on the nose, but it works, and it's the kind of overdramatic nonsense that Jin would find incredibly, appealing. And it's only been, what, an hour, 45 minutes? I don't know how long this is gonna take, but we're finally on to issue 3, where, just in case you didn't get it at the end of the last one, we're doing more puppetry imagery, because you know, why not? Hello, Mr. Car outside driving past, you sure have a loud engine. So, in this issue, Zed and Shen finally, well, run into each other, and we get a lot of access to Zed's internal monologue through his thought bubbles, which, by the way, I like the effect of having, like, the red outline and the sort of the steely shine on the color on the inside, as though it's, like, as though it's representative of the character himself, all red and steel. Blood, steel, that kind of thing. Very efficient. Unfortunately, the only man I can trust is also the man who most wants to kill me, and if he won't listen to reason, then, like, Zed knows that Shen probably can kill him if he wants to. And this is, again, where I'm gonna bring up the criticism that you've heard 15 times already. Like, this is a better panel, I think, because especially with the darkness of Zed's shadow magic versus the light of Shen's spirit magic, there's much more of a distinction between where they are in the space. Like, there's heavier shadows on Zed, which makes sense, but also because he's further ahead in space. There is variety in line thickness that puts him closer to us as the viewer. But still, I wish this pillar right here, why that's there, I don't understand. Why they blocked off part of the image here, sacrificing a lot of the depth of this illustration. Let's take a look at it from here. It's like, this just feels like a big block doing nothing for the composition of the image. Like, it just makes, like, this makes Shen, like, compositionally here, Zed looks really threatening because he takes up a lot of space, he's sheathed in magic, he's got the two blades, he's eating up most of the composition of the image. Shen, on the other hand, looks defensive and threatened. He looks small and he looks constrained because he's shut in between the magic, Zed's leg, And then this fucking thing, like this pillar or door frame or whatever the hell it is shutting him into this tiny little space down here that it doesn't aid the idea that, oh shit, Zed has just run into an extremely powerful enemy who can kill him. More of a, oh, this guy is on the defensive and he's constrained and in trouble because they're letting the magic effect box him in, basically. Which is a compositional thing. I was like, but like I said, I like the emphasis, like how much they used shadows and darkness and line thickness to emphasize where Zed is in the image. That looks really good. It's just Shen's positioning doesn't really work for me. And again, here, like, I'm not, I know what Shen's upper body is doing, and Zed's pose is good, but what's his lower body doing? Like, what is this? Like, which direction is he moving in, is the question that I have, because first he drops down low into a crouch, and then I guess he jumps and slashes at Zed, but then what's his motion? Where is he moving? Like, he brings the sword down this way. So I guess, is he falling toward, like, did he jump up and then fall down towards Zed? Or is he charging at him? Or is he coming from this direction right here? Like, all the speed lines in this image point to here. Like, they point towards the center of the image. But that would imply that Shen somehow came from the side of Zed? Which, how? Because they're facing each other. So, again, that's... directionality and speed doesn't work. This panel, though, really good. Like, this is the opposite of the compositional problem I outlined up here. We can see that Zed is being pressed. We can see that Shen is completely dominating the fight because he's pushing forward. He dominates the frame, like he's way larger than poor Zed, and Zed is pressed up against this wall that's cracking behind him, right? This composition does a much better job of telling the story of the situation than that one does, I think. So, here we have dropped into a flashback, where, like, we see how Zed got his iconic armor, which it turns out it's the battle armor of some part of the Kinku Order. And this is also where Zed makes the decision to betray the Kinku Order and steal the Tears of the Shadow. No, that magic is forbidden. I'm sorry, Usan, I failed you as a master. I remember the strong scent of the comb tree, sickly sweet even in that cold wind. I did not impart you with the wisdom to see the necessity of keeping the Kinku pure. What is war and death in the face of eternity balances? Keep your words. I will take the box and the magic ichor it contains. The tears are too powerful because they are not of our world, because they do not belong in our world. Walk with me. See it for the evil it is and destroy it with me. Then bring your students into balance. Usan, wait!
The reason I'm narrating this out is because this is an incredibly important moment in the story. Especially for the twist that's coming on later down the line. The Tears of the Shadow, when consumed or tattooed, give the user the shadow magic for which my order is named. Again, a little bit of world building, important information to have. And then we get to the tears themselves, and there's a really, really, really cool idea here. That the shadows, like, they're so powerful that they distort the space around you, and you can see that it's being used compositionally here to start to take over Zed's face and his mind, his head, showing... like, a visual signifier of corruption by power, basically. Which works really well. It's a really cool visual idea. The composition here just betrays it a little bit again. Like, because, again, there's the fly swatting. Why is Zed holding this thing out to the side? Why isn't he offering it forward towards the people that he's talking about? Why is his arm here? Like, again, he's got the blood on his claws. Why is that fly swatted out to the side rather than pointing into the space being extended so that he's extending both the power of shadow magic but also the bloodied hand that killed the master of the order? Why isn't that happening more? The fly swatting is weakening the composition. It's weakening the pose and the acting, and it weakens the speech. The speech is so important, which is also where... I don't want to harp on the letterer too much, because he's clearly working on this in commission. But this is the iconic... this is the big speech. This is Zed announcing his betrayal of the Kinku Order. This is Zed trying to rally followers to him who will fight Noxus on his side in his new Order of Shadows. So why is this lettered like he's just talking? Kusha was weak. This has made your order weak. I offer strength! Join us and fight for our homeland. Like, lettering can do so much more. And doesn't have to be there all the time. But, like, here, at least, when we have the speech of like, I'm betraying the Kinku Order. This is the pivotal moment of my life and my existence. It should probably be like something. This moment is too important to not do something extra with the talk, with the speech. Here again, love me that inky shadow. Like that's good. I love that as an idea. One thing I have a bit of trouble with Shen is that one of Shen's defining characteristics is that he's the Eye of the Twilight. He sees both the physical and the spirit realm at the same time, and that's signified by, well, his eyes being white. He has no pupils, he just has bright white eyes that glow, actually. But then they don't take advantage of it, really. Like, a lot of the time when Shen's face is on screen, it just looks like someone forgot to draw his pupils more than it looks like he's got special magic glowing eyes. I think something more could have been done there. And I think, like, here, Zed's eyes are glowing through the magic shadow. Shen, for some reason, his bright white glowing magic eyes aren't visible, which is, again, like I said at the start of this video, this very, very long video, nitpicks. Nitpicky, 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 but it all adds up to a bunch of stuff that just... It just kind of doesn't work for me. Similarly, this completely straight arm stretch thing doesn't work for me. He's stabbing the daggers into the table. You don't do that by stretching out your arms 100% in front of you and bringing them down. When you stab something into a thing, like, try and do it with your own arms. Like, would you stab something by completely extending your arm straight and then bringing it down? No, you pivot around the pivot of your elbow. Small thing, but it's those, like, I've outlined dozens of little things. All of them in combination bother me. Each one individually doesn't. Here, again, we have a speech, right? Why is his mouth closed? And why aren't his, like, here is where where Shen is at his angriest, where he's like, I just fucking want to murder you right now, but like, he's got all this rage inside him that's begging to be let out. And you have magic glowing eyes that would serve as the perfect way to show that. To show that he's barely containing his power, his energy, his rage right now. And you can see they're kind of doing that with, like, the hyper-tensed muscle vein on his arm, like, which is good. And that's also where a pose like this works better, because he is clenching everything in his body not to try and murder Zed right there on the spot. And it's just, like, these little things that just let it down, I think. And then we have this sequence, which is actually one of the cooler little moments of levity, where, again, is it just me or does Akali look 35 here? Like, she doesn't look as old as poor Kane sometimes does, but she doesn't look 18, does she? Like, it's not just the rendering. Like, there's a bunch of lines on her face that, because of the way stylization tends to work with character faces, makes her look older. But it's also the proportions of her face. Like, this is the proportions of an adult woman's face. This is not the proportions of a barely grown-up teenager's face, which is what Akali is supposed to be, a young, impulsive, impetuous teenager. And it's the same thing with Kane. It's like, he could look a lot younger, actually. Like, here. This scene is so nicely written. Like, I really... Here, Kane is trying to flirt with her, and she's like, it's your eyes. I mean, I hate admitting it, but the abs, the shirtless thing actually works for me. But those eyes, crazy. You're hot, but crazy. She flirts back a little bit. That's a really cute scene. I really like that interaction between the two characters, but no one in their right mind. That's not a flirty face. What the fuck is that supposed to be? He looks like a 50-year-old man hitting on a college student. Like, eh. This isn't charming. It's not even like youthful idiot charming. It's not even like he's like a 19-year-old playing at what he thinks an adult does when they flirt. He just looks... Well, I don't even know what he's supposed to look like, but he doesn't look charming or attractive. So when Akali is like, oh, the abs, the shirtless thing, that works for me. I don't believe her because this is what she's looking at. What the hell? No, absolutely. Your mileage may vary, but for me, the art lets this scene down so hard because it's supposed to be this funny, playful, like, moment of flirting and interaction between two people who are in similar positions. Like, Akali and Kane are like mirror images of each other. In terms of, like, Akali is the student of Shen, who is disloyal to him, thinks he's kind of an old idiot who doesn't take things seriously enough and is struck out on her own, whereas Kane is a... little shit also, but he's fiercely loyal to his master and thinks the world of Zed. And thinks that Zed is right about everything, where, like, Akali is much more rebellious. There's this mirror image dynamic going on that's so fun and so cool, and the art just... No! No, this doesn't work at all! I do like the little detail about Kane's character design, is that you can see the corruption of Rost starting to get to him a little bit. So again, a little bit of an action scene, more of the same exact action scene critique I've already had. Akali is trying to charge at Zed here, like she's jumping at him with weapons and stuff. This pose doesn't do a great job of communicating that to me. Like, which way is she jumping? Is she jumping at him? Because if she is, then her knee shouldn't be going this way. Is she trying to circle around the side of him? Well, then her upper body shouldn't be going that. Something about this just doesn't work for me. And the lack of speed lines, again, doesn't help the lack of communication of direction on what she's doing. Also, why do all of her daggers miss? To me, that's like, Zed is just walking forward and then all of her daggers fly past him. And then he just blocks her and then he leaves. What? That's a weird fight choreography. At least he should dodge them, like, easily parry them, but he just... I don't know what this fight scene was supposed to be for, except to show that Akali doesn't respect Shen's orders. So, here, Zed names Kane his successor as leader of the Order of Shadows in case that, you know, Zed dies trying to kill Kata Jin. This is one of the happiest moments of Kane's life, at least supposedly. That's his expression. I don't know what that expression is. I think Kane was let down terribly by a lot of the art in this comic, I'm afraid. We follow that with a montage, and the montage I want to compliment. I think that works really well. Again, some of the stuff we talked about earlier, using different color schemes to delineate the different environments that the characters are moving to, again, helps bridge the gap. Like, if you removed all the colors, you could probably still suss out, okay, this is like, they're not moving directly from one place to another. There's a gap in time between each point where, like, they're... Like, it's Shen and Akali moving around, doing investigations, trying to figure out where Jin is and what he's up to. The color does a great job of aiding that. The color really, really helps sell, like, okay, here they're like a village scene, blah, blah, greens, some dark teals and stuff like that. Here, moonlight. Here, it's like twilight or the end of the day or early morning, either or. But we've got, like, Zed being highlighted by this yellow, daub as he sits up in the tree, and then the greens, and then we have like the scene inside, and then we have the scene here at the market. The colors are doing a fantastic job of helping aid the transition in time from one panel to another. And the art is also pretty good in these panels. Like here, I feel like there's a much better, like this feels a lot more like Akali is way down on the ground far away and Shen is standing on a tower much closer. This feels a lot more like they're standing, because you can also see the slight distortion of the bridge's shape, right? This feels a lot more like there's a deep field. The compositions here work really well. I really like this scene, both in terms of the art, and also the writing is quite clever, because we're getting a lot of classic murder mystery information. Lord Jaitha died with all 15 of his family members on that ship. 16. Jin's obsessed with the number 4. His victims are always in units of 4. Like, all of that stuff works really well for me. And that continues into, like, the rest of Shen and Akali's investigation. Is like, there's a lot of good writing going on here. And I'm not going to go through the whole thing, where we're getting a lot of world building. I think the spirits, the Nanthi Elder, has the good sense to stand against those nationalist bullies after Master Olthan and Jaitha's family were wiped out. He's one of the last holdouts. Like, we're getting a lot of world building information about the politics of Ionia, the relationships between different factions, the reasons why they may like or not like one another, like their standings, and the political machinations that are happening in the background, while what we're focused on as readers is the investigation of, like, what the hell is Jin doing? And so, after 10,000 years, we make it to issue 4. This is, like I said, gonna be a very long video. And I really like this cover. Like, more than I've liked the other ones. This one, again, works really well, because I would really have liked for just to have a little bit of overlap between Zed and his armor and stuff, and a little bit of overlap over Shen, so that we really see that one is in front of the other. Because this too, like, this thing of avoiding the overlap at all costs, and you can really see it, like, they've just oh, they've been so careful. Nothing about Zed overlaps Shen in any way or whatsoever, because we spent a lot of time drawing this ninja, and we're not going to let anything overlap him now. That's also part of what fly swatting is an unwillingness to hide any part of your work behind other work. That's my only nitpick. Like, the rest of this, like, they look badass. They look cool. I like the framing of the scene. I like the Ionian architecture being replicated so faithfully. I like the shadows. I like the effects on, like, the contrast between spirit magic and shadow again in this panel. Really nice cover. I just wanted to compliment it because I've been so negative the whole time, which is the thing that always happens in these bloody videos. Is like, I feel like I try to be positive. I try to say all the things I do like, because there's so much I like, and we'll talk about that at length later. But I just can't help but end up focusing more on the negatives. It's an unfortunate thing, because a lot of the stuff I like, I just feel like, well, that's obviously good. I don't need to say anything. For example, these giant heads. Those are cool. That's a cool little world-building detail that, for some reason, apparently, some Ionian villages just have giant heads in them. Again, I also like the perspective here a lot better, because you can see how the tree here is deepening the space by giving us more of a, like, by giving us more of a sense of distance and direction of the things that are close and that are far away. I like the use of, well, basically what you would know in gaming as LOD, but like, you can see how the details in the buildings fade as we move further and further away from the camera, air quotes, further and further away from the vantage point, and the details arrive in more force the closer we get. That's a really nice little artistic technique to create depth in the space, and it works really well here. This is a much better, like, rather than that the snowy mountain overlooking the burning village, which really didn't work for me, this works for me a lot. This is a really nice panel. This is a really nice establishing shot. Anyway, Zed has realized that there are bombs in the village. They are in the lanterns. He's going to try and tell Shen about it, but Shen predictably is not going to be inclined to listen. But again, those shadows, man, that's like, oh, those shadow effects are just so badass. Like, it really feels like, I think it was like an ink brush that the guy, like, that the artist is really just kind of slathering around there and creating these really compelling little trails and curves, and ooh, it looks really nice. And then the colorist has added some lighter areas of interest on top of that. Love them. I want to emphasize that there's a lot of good stuff here in the art as well, even though, yes, I know I'm complaining a lot. More compliments. I like these explosions. Like, these explosions look good to me. And I like the progression in intensity. Here again is a copy-pasted panel. Like, and again, not necessarily literally copy-pasted. I don't think that's actually been done, but the art has been very closely replicated from panel to panel. But here, the effect of transition is much better than it was in the fight scene with Master Alphen, where you can see the beginning of the explosion, and you can see the reaction of the people looking at it. And you can see the village, like, progressively being consumed in flame and fire. Like, that works really well. And this is a fantastic panel. Again, compositionally, I don't know why that's there. Like, why is, like, I think it's to deepen the space a little bit, but here's where I would have just had the beam and Jin standing on it and reveling in it, because the rest of the panel, I love the use of pinks and purples and blues and like, all of these colors that feel unnatural for explosions to really highlight the artistic nature of Jin's absolute carnage, but also just to make it look so otherworldly and weird and gaudy and excessive, because it is. And also, Jin outlined against the results of his own explosion, really good. I would have probably made him a completely black silhouette, like, without the little edge lighting on him, but that's not a criticism, that's just, if I was drawing the panel, that's what I would have done. Not so much they're doing it wrong, as I would have done it differently. So, here we get one of the best scenes in the comic. In fact, the best one of all. This is my favorite scene in the entire comic. Partly because the art is actually quite good, but also the writing. This is the best moment between these two characters that we get. Zed, draw your weapons. Like, Zed has just rescued Shen from the sea where Shen was drowning. But Shen is not really willing to let go of his anger. But he has more reasons than just being pissed about, like, Zed killing his dad. Look around, how many are dead? This is why you have to help me. This is why Jin has to be stopped. Fool! You were his audience! And that's such a good reveal. Like, that's a good twist that Shen has figured out why Jin is doing all this. He attacked this town because he knew you would take the bait, because he knew you would come after him. If you had stayed in some rural temple far away from people, he would have gone looking for you. No, he's working for someone. This was a performance for you. These people died because of you. And he'll kill much more. The rule of the scales. Look around you. Father's lesson had more than one part. Action only when needed. You took action not because it was the right course, but because you were afraid. Afraid of waiting. Afraid of things getting worse. Because you knew Jin would come for you, so you came here. Here! You could have stayed in the wilds, waited for him in a forest. Instead, you take action without patience. You walk into traps. That is why you failed to serve Kinku. That is why you failed my father. That is why you lose now. That is such a good fucking scene, because we have already been told all of this about Zed. We've been told that Zed is impatient, that Zed looks for reasons to do the things that he wants, reasons that justify him taking action that isn't necessarily good, like kissing his lover on the night when he left the Kinku Order so that he would have yet another reason to leave. Right? That's already been established. All of it's been established. And we have also already established, by observing what Jin does, that of course Zed was Jin's audience. If Zed hadn't been there, there would have been no point detonating the bombs. Jin wouldn't have given a shit. It was all for Zed, and Zed walked right into that goddamn trap while justifying everything to him every step of the way by, no, I'm doing the right thing. I'm chasing after him. I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna take action, and I'm following the advice of my old master, blah, blah. And what Shen does here is completely fucking dismantle him and go, you fucking moron. You played into his hands and you did it for the same reason that you betrayed my father. You did it for the same reason you've done everything, which is fear. You're afraid. And of course, Zed is afraid. He hates himself. He's motivated by self-hatred. And that's why self-hatred can be such a good motivation for storytelling, is because if Zed was more self, wasn't a person who has all this self-hate, who has all this guilt, this martyr complex, this need to fix everything all the time, he would never have done any of this. He would never have made these mistakes. We would never have gotten these moments. We would never have had that confrontation with Jin or between these two guys. And the art also does a pretty good job, because Zed, during this entire fight, and this is where fight choreography can be so good in comics and indeed movies, is you can use the fight to tell the story of the character's relationship. And here, Shen is giving him an absolute motherfucking beatdown. He's literally face-planting in the sand. As Shen is dismantling and completely, like, taking apart Zed's hypocrisies and his stupidities and his mistakes and his foolishness, Zed is also completely on the defensive, dodging, falling over, falling down, getting thrown around, because Shen is beating the shit out of him. And that's really good fight choreography. That's really good synergy between what the story, what the lore, what the dialogue is doing, and what the action on screen, or on the page, rather, is doing. That's really good. I really like that. This is my favorite scene in the whole comic. It's excellently executed, and I also like the action sequences here more than I have any of the others. Not just because it does a good job of integrating with the story, but because I think the compositions are much better. Because I think it lands a lot better than it has. There's more speed lines, there's more clarity of action. I love this jump pose from Shen. Like, because again, you can see the directionality of exactly what he wants to do, and the speed lines are aiding in that. So this I have nothing but praise for. This is so good. And as you can tell from the current shift in my tone of voice, it's so good, and it makes something that happens later kind of disappointing because of it. We'll get to that in the final issue of the story. For the moment, we're getting a flashback to how Zed and Shen's relationship began, as Master Kusho is training his son in the courtyard late at night, presumably, and Zed is just a lowly peasant boy, a nobody from nowhere, who hasn't been taken on by a master, who isn't being trained by anyone. And so Kusho's like, okay, why don't we just let my son beat the shit out of you for a while? Like, just really kick the crap out of him, completely own his shit 7 ways from Sunday, and Zed keeps getting up again and again and again and again, until finally he gets an opening and manages to land a decisive hit. And so Zed is taken on as an apprentice. This is like a good backstory moment. This is like a really, two boys who are like united by their stern father figure who like takes on this boy who has nothing and gives him everything, and then also Zed manages to teach humility to Shen, who needs that lesson. Hey, that's like from every martial arts kung fu movie, like that's a really good backstory for such like a pair of adopted brothers, basically. And the beatdown continues. Do not force me, with a bit of stilted dialogue, I think. Like, where Zed is remembering the past, I said, "Stay down, Zed. Stop this, Shen. Do not force me to kill you with my shadow clones." Where it feels a lot like the writer was like, I need to have a reason for Shen to make Zed look at his shadow clones. So we just have Zed spell it out like, "I will kill you with my shadow clones," which feels like badly translated kung fu movie dialogue. Shadow clones, bah. And all the times you've used them, did you ever really look at their faces? It is your guilt and hatred that gives them shape. They don't serve you. They control you. Again, more beatdown of Zed, more realizations, and more Shen dismantling his old brother. And here, the text is being used, like, unlike with the speech that Zed gave to the Kinku Order, here, the text is being used really well to emphasize the pacing and the intonation of what Shen is saying. And here, the expression is really, really good. Like, here, the expressions are being pushed. Here, you can really see the entirety of Shen's face, like, screwed up in pain and suffering and anger and regret and misery and grief pouring out of him as his aggression slowly begins to fade away. And so, we make it to issue 5. I have aged 200 years in the meantime, and I don't know how old you all are, but I hope you have paid your taxes in all the time you've been stuck here. The cover is doing a good job of telling us the stakes of the story right now. It's Shen versus Jin and Zed tied up in chains. Very kinky, very sexy, but unfortunately, that's not the context of what's going on. Zed is captured in this wagon full of, like, nullification tags that suppresses shadow magic, as Shen takes him back to the monastery. "When we fought on the beach, you held back," Zed. "I was unconscious and drowning. You dragged me from the water. You always hid your strength, even as a kid." "I was weak as a child. You were quickly the strongest of us. Everything I became was just me trying to keep up with you." "I'd say the same about you, Shen." Again, more excellent character building of the relationship between these two men, the ways that they relate to each other. The fact that, hey, actually for quite a long time, a lot of Shen's motivation was driven by, like, this really good rivalry relationship, like classic Naruto Sasuke thing, at least up until the bit where Sasuke runs away to the, you know, Naruto got really kind of bad after a while. But classic that kind of dynamic between these two brothers who are pushing each other to be better and better, but then they go their separate ways someday, and there's all these resentments and old anxieties and fears and so much love hidden in that. Like, all of that good angsty pain. I love it. And here we come to, yeah. Here we come to something that could be so good. So good. But the twist. And I'm gonna feel bad about ragging on this so much, but I don't like it. I don't like it all, at all. And I really love it at the same time. So, Shen wants Zed to tell him why he killed Master Kusho. "Why did you kill my father? When the foreigners invaded, you saw the suffering, Shen. I needed to be powerful enough to stop them. Master Kusho didn't understand. When I came back to take the magic of the shadow's tear, he tried to stop me." "A lie, U-san. You could have beaten father and taken the ichor without taking his life." "You're the good son, but I did what was needed. The truth of the scales." This right here, the truth of the scales, is the lesson that Zed learns at that murder scene that Jin committed, where he has to let one die to save three. That's the lesson of the scales that Zed has become kind of obsessed with. It's become kind of a driving motivation of his life. "Another lie. I was the one that started sneaking out. I was the one that secretly started training soldiers to fight for our homeland, arming them with magic. I was the one that started attacking enemy supply lines. While you covered for me, you threw fights to make it look like I was spending my time away from the temple training." "I knew you were right, Shen. You took only but a sip for a few weeks, stolen weeks. I drank oceans from the darkness." That's an attempt at poetry, but ooh boy. "Attached it to my skin, made it my life. You cut off enemy supply lines. I cut off their heads." I can see what the writer's going for here. I feel like this is a little cliche tropey. It's a little much, isn't it? Like, just speak plainly. Damn it, Usan, tell me the truth. Why did you kill him? I was jealous of you. You were the one he loved. I needed the shadow magic to grow stronger. An old story you heard and then pretended to be true. Lie to your students, lie to yourself, but you can't lie to me, Ushan. Kusha was your father as much as mine. Tell me what happened. You want me to say that it wasn't my fault, but that isn't true. You want me to say it was an accident, but it wasn't an accident, Shen. As I traveled from Thanzai, I realized Master Kusha was right. The Kinku's mission to protect the balance between the spirits of men would be tainted by war. We would not be able to go back. The Kinku would become no better than a warrior clan, mercenaries, assassins, bounty hunt killers. Those are father's words. Yes. To save our homeland, a new order had to be created. It had to do what the Kinku could not. It had to defy tradition, it had to defy balance. But if I had simply defied Master Kusha or beaten him, the others would have joined me. You would have joined me, and the Kinku would have become desecrated and lost. To save the Kinku, my new order had to be their hated enemy. So in the darkness of the temple, I let Kusha try to convince me, and pretended to be swayed by his words. Then, thinking I had returned to him in the Kinku, he embraced me and I stabbed your father in the heart. I made my choice. I know what I am and what I've become. This is really fucking good. That's really good. Like, that really should be the truth. That feels like a reasoning that someone who's so driven by a martyr complex, by self-hate, like, is that, I'll be the hero you need, but that you deserve, but not the one you need right now. This sort of Batman Dark Knight, I'll be persecuted by the public in order to do the right thing. Preserving the purity of the rest of the world by taking the sins onto yourself, by becoming a scapegoat. That feels very, very true to the character of Zed that we've seen so far. This boy who has always felt unworthy, who has always felt less than, who has always felt like he was handed so many gifts that he wasn't worthy of. That feels like the kind of thing that he would do as the insecure second banana, the guy who's always trying to play catch-up to the favored son, the one who was never worthy of being the true successor, the one who was always too impatient, too rash, who never thought properly about his actions, who never took the lessons to heart. Like, all of that shit ties into this brilliantly. This is a fantastic exploration of the kinds of motivations that Zed might have that would cause him to do what he does and feel that he is justified. And it's certainly a good enough explanation for Shen as well, who then sets Zed free and allows him to join him in the fight against Kara Jin on the order, on the oath that Jin will not die because that is not the Kinku way. And like Shen is like, I'm going to kill him, I'm going to kill him. Nope, he has to live because balance, because Kinku, blah, blah. I'm not Kinku! I will not give you the last grasp at redemption you seek, Ushan. I will not let you die thinking father was wrong and you were right. If you wish to help me fight Jin, this is the price. Again, such a good character moment between the two, where Shen isn't allowing Zed to find redemption. In the sense that he's not allowed... on the assumption that Zed, at least in part, is trying to prove Master Kusha wrong. Is trying to prove that his actions are justified, that there is some truth and goodness in the thing that he's chosen to do. And Shen is like, no, you're stupid, you're fucked up, everything you do is bad and stupid. If you want to help me fight him, we're going to do this right. We're going to do it the right way. Because there is a right. And in part, like, Shen hasn't forgiven him, but he's still trying to teach him the right way. Like, he still can't help but try and set his brother right. Not that he doesn't hate him, but that little spark of the relationship is still there. And that's so fucking good. Which makes the twist... which makes the twist all the worse. And so we come to the sixth and final issue of this comic, where all the brilliant writing, all that good characterization, all those character motivations, all those horrible, angsty feelings between the two estranged brothers come to a head. And depending on how you feel... to a glorious crescendo. I feel less like that. So recapping the action, we're in Zaun. Jin is there, he's taken Akali prisoner. Shen and Zed have to team up to fight him, to try and sort of that. And they manage basically to succeed because, well, they get Akali free and she sucker punches Jin right in the stupid head and nearly kills him until Zed prevents her from doing the thing that he has sworn won't happen. I promised Shen we would take you alive, Jin, so my honor forbids me from killing you, but I can make you wish you were dead. Tell us how you escaped Tula prison.
Zed, I didn't escape, you know that. Who led you out?
No, I'm sorry, Zed, but I'm afraid I won't say. Besides, you already know who set me free.
You've known all along.
Think of it this way, Zed. I was set free, but now that means you're free, too.
Take him. Our bargain is done. He's done, but we aren't done.
And then Zed leaves. Who set Jin free from the prison? Now, my assumption when I was reading this thing is that it's going to turn out to have been Yevnai. Like, the Shen's former fiancé and Zed's former lover, whom, like, I'd have some pretty fucking reasonable reasons to want both of them to suffer for what they've done to her. Like, she could have been a good secret surprise villain reveal. The one we actually got was, it's Lord Kusho. Shen's father has been alive this whole entire time, and he's been the Darth Sidious behind the scenes. He's been the evil emperor. He's been the guy.
Shen still believes I'm dead. You did not tell him of our deception. I gave you my word and my honor, Lord Kusho, but you were hoping to get Shen to investigate who let Jin out?
Yes.
And now what do you intend to do? Call me a demon? Say I went too far when I released Kata Jin.
Kusho has been alive this whole time. He's secretly the leader of the Order of Shadows. He's secretly evil. And it... I don't feel positive about this twist at all, as you can probably tell. And I'm not going to sit here and pretend like this is some objective, oh, this is objectively bad, like Snoke getting killed in The Last Jedi is objective. Like that kind of shit? No. I feel this doesn't work at all, and I'm going to try to articulate why, but I'm not, don't get caught up in a sort of, oh, this is objectively bad because of writing rules or whatever. But here's why I don't think it works. So, as the story transpires, the reason why Zed has been doing everything, all of it, all those years ago you convinced me to fake my death, thus the Kinku could stay as it was, pure in its mission to maintain the balance while freeing us to use the forbidden magics and for me to take control of the Navori Brotherhood, so you could lead our country to safety from behind the scenes, and I did, and now I will unify Ionia. People would want to forget the war and go back to the way things were, so now we must remind them of the horrors of war, the sort of mass carnage and terror you were unwilling to do or even allow. This is why I needed Jin. People do not unwillingly kneel unless they are afraid. People already believe the attack on Nanthi was for an agent's. Come, Zed, it's not too late. A few more attacks on the other cities and all of Sion will join us willingly, and then all of Ionia, join me, and we shall rule the galaxy as father and son. So, it turns out that Zed managed to convince Lord Kusho, like, the thing he said to Jin last time was the truth, or at least most of it. That Zed believed a new order had to be there that the Kinku could hate and stand against so that they could do what was necessary to win the war without tainting the Kinku order. Except, Zed didn't take power for himself. He allowed Lord Kusho to take power, and now Lord Kusho has, like, gone full Fu Manchu and been corrupted by the shadow magic and blah 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 bad stuff, turns into a shadow demon drinking the evil goop stuff, and we get, like, this final, like, evil god emperor villain confrontation, and then Zed actually kills Lord Kusho and does the thing that he apparently hadn't done the whole time. And the justification at the end, which, you know, works well enough. When seeking to restore the balance, one should only take action only when needed. One should take action only when needed and be inspired by the merchant trading. Though many items may be on each side of his scales, he seeks to remove only the smallest object because nothing is truly wholly good or evil. We realize sometimes you must lose one to save many. This is the lesson of the scales. I am its executioner. I am Zed. Finally, he kills Lord Kusho, the thing that everyone thinks he's already done. Not because Kusho was evil, but because Kusho had become corrupted by evil spirit magic, blah, 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 blah. And then you used me and set me on this path to damnation. You were just a punching bag to train my son with, so desperate. And when I gave you your name, Usan, you cried, and you were mine, a useful tool. And then you used me because I saw what you really were, and I let you become it, more like me than my own son. Do you remember when your mother finally found you at the monastery? On the stairway, she wailed for you to come home, but you refused to even greet her and let her be dragged away. Yevna, I loved you. That girl would have run away with you even when she was betrothed to my son, but you didn't go. Like, he's taunting her. He's giving this whole thing. And Zed is like, but I only did what I did in service to you. Like, that's the whole thing is, it turns out that Zed, what he has done, everything he's been, everything that's been going on. And by the way, Kusho is lying here. Like, he's taunting him. He's being cruel and evil and saying things that are probably not quite true. But Zed's motivation, before it was so good. He was this kid who'd been given a good life by a good man and a good father. And who had made all of these decisions out of this constant pervasive sense of inferiority and fear and inability to believe himself worthy of the things that he has and this martyr complex. I have to save everyone. I have to do all the things. I must do what no one else can. Like, all of that shit. Like, if sins must be committed, then I will commit them to save others from the stain, which is a very true and believable motivation. That's how a lot of people justify doing really bad shit to themselves. Instead, becomes, oh no, wait, it was his dad. His dad manipulated the whole thing behind the scenes the whole time. Zed didn't make any choices. Zed just followed orders. Zed just did what he was told. That's why it doesn't work for me. Zed's agency as an agent in his own story. All of this stuff about, like, his motivations, why he might choose to make these decisions, crumbles when it turns out that what he actually did, he never made an evil, no, he never killed Lord Kusho. He would never do that. Zed is a good man. He's a good son. He's a nice boy. He would never do anything truly evil or immoral in service of what he thinks is the higher good. No, it was his evil dad that did the whole thing. His dad got corrupt. His dad let Zed do the bad things. Zed isn't really guilty. He didn't really do the thing. And at the end, when he finally does kill Lord Kusho, when he finally does the thing that his story so far has been about dealing with the consequences of doing, instead of it being an act of brutal murder in service of something that he believes in, it's redemptive. Oh, he kills Lord Kusho to free him from the corruption of the Shadow Tears, blah, blah, blah. Oh, he's sitting with his sunbeam and he's a good son and he loves him and he cares for him and he didn't want to kill him, but he had to. I like Zed so much more. So much more. He's such a more compelling character, a more compelling villain, a more compelling antihero, a more compelling hero and protagonist. When he has made his choices and done terrible things of his own volition because of his own character flaws, because of his own experiences, because of his own personality, because of him. But when it turns out that he's been doing all of this Master of Shadows bullshit the whole time, because his dad told him to. And yes, Zed convinced Kusho to go along with him. Sure, you can argue that that's his sin. But the impact is just diminished for me. For me, it just takes all of the air out of the balloon, all the tension, all the angst. It's like, oh, it turns out Zed didn't actually commit the crime. Like, the one defining moment of his life, as we talked about when I was talking about the speech itself, the defining moment of Zed's life is the moment when he decides to apply the lesson of the scales. It is better that I kill Master Kusho now rather than let the Kinku order become corrupted. That was the lesson of the scales as he applied it to the murder of Master Kusho. A necessary act, an evil act perhaps, something cruel, something unforgivable perhaps, but necessary because of the lesson of the scales. Except, he didn't do that. He didn't do that at all. And now they come to this part where it's like, ah, this is the lesson of the scales. Sometimes you must lose one to save many, which, like, yeah, I guess it's true here, but now he's not murdering a good man. Like, now he's not doing something that is objectively evil in order to ensure a greater good. He's killing a shadow demon from hell. Like, that's not the lesson of the scales. That's just like, who the fuck wouldn't? Like, of course that guy has to die. Look at him. Look at what he's doing. This is like evil demon guy from hell. This is, by the way, this is what Shen was doing in the very first appearance he had in the comic. Like, in Shen's very first appearance, the first thing we see him doing is putting down a raging evil demon that has gone out of control and being like, oh, I'm sorry I had to kill you, but it was the only way to restore balance. That's the connection that they're attempting to establish here, is that Zed and Shen kind of do the same thing, but in different arenas. But it's like, there's no moral ambiguity here. Of course, what the fuck else are you gonna do with evil demon from hell? You kill it. That's an objectively good action. Of course he has to die. Like, but Master Kusho at the Kinku Order, like, this defenseless master who had laid down his sword and was walking with his son, betraying him at the darkest possible moment to ensure the greater good, that's a compelling, like, that's a holy shit, that's some shit you gotta deal with. That's some feelings you gotta deal with. That's some guilt you gotta deal with. But this is just like, and this is, it just doesn't, it has no impact for me. And I want to stress that this is for me, this whole thing devalues all of Zed's character development up to that point. It devalues his determination and his whole, like, I'm doing the right thing, even if other people can't see that, even if I have to suffer for it, I'm doing the right thing, I'm making sacrifices for the greater good. And Shen being like, no, you are not, you fucking moron, you're acting on all your insecurities and your worst instincts, and Zed struggling with that? Now, Shen's whole beatdown, Shen's whole deconstruction of who Zed is and why Zed does the things that he does, is also completely weakened, because it turns out, hey, he was just doing it because his dad told him to. It doesn't work for me. I hope I've managed to articulate why. It's not a thing of just like, oh, it's dumb that he's alive. No, like, Kusho being alive could be a great twist. Kusho being evil could be a great twist. That's kind of fine. But the whole thing about Zed only did evil, bad things because Kusho essentially told him to. Because Kusho essentially enabled him, seduced him, led him down the dark path. Just because it was Zed's idea originally and Kusho went along with it, it's still, like, the agency that's removed from Zed just... it just becomes so uncompelling to me. Zed was such a compelling fucking anti-hero. Right up until this. Right up until this, the relationship between Shen and Zed, like, that contentious bone of, like, because Shen kills a demon at the start of the story, because, I mean, there's no other way. He knows this as the Eye of Twilight. Balance has to be preserved. Sometimes that means you have to kill something, whether or not it deserves to die. Sometimes that means someone has to be kept alive, whether or not they deserve to die, which is why he refuses to kill Jin, because Jin is a man, and there are rules about that kind of shit. Zed does the same thing, but in reverse. He kills Kusho, a man, who, like, there are rules about that sort of thing, but Zed is doing the same thing from a different perspective. It's better that Kusho dies than having the entire Kinku Order corrupted. Except he didn't. That whole choice, that whole basis of his character, the basis of his relationship with Shen, the basis of the thematic between them, gone. It's... well, not completely gone. You can argue that it's still there, but it's so weak now, because Zed didn't do that. He didn't make that choice at all. He didn't betray the Kinku Order at all. He didn't do the terrible, unforgivable, point of no return action that everyone thinks he did, because he's a good guy. And that's the thing, is like, I feel the motivation behind this story change, this twist. And I think feel the motivation behind the entire comic is, to a certain extent, to rehabilitate Zed as a compelling anti-hero. Because, as we talked about in his original story, the original version of who he was, it was very much about, meh, but I wanted to be the master of the Kinku Order, meh. Like, it was very much that, like, the impatient student killing his master for power thing, which is, like, fine, but not that compelling, and it makes him a pretty unambiguous villain that you kind of can't do anything else with, which was then, later on, through some retcons and stuff, was deepened a little bit into, okay, he's still like this, but I want to be the master of the King Quarter, but he's now doing it with the motivation of, well, holy shit, Noxus is invading and killing everybody, we have to do something about it, my master won't act, so I kill him impatiently and take the power for myself and become the Master of Shadows, blah blah blah, Navori Brotherhood, fight with Noxus. This is another step down that path of, like, rehabilitating Zed away from being just an unambiguous evil ninja villain into someone who can play the part of an anti-hero or even a hero, depending on the circumstances. And they do such a good job. Like, I want to stress this. So much of this is so, so, so good. But then they take one step too far. Like, this is just, it's one step too far. It's trying too hard to rehabilitate Zed. It's trying too hard to make him a good guy, which he shouldn't be. He should be someone who has made a terrible, terrible choice for what he believes truly to be the greater good. And Shen should have to struggle with that. Shen should have to struggle with the fear that what if Zed is kind of right. Like, that should be the fear in the back of Shen's head all the time, is that, like, what if it was necessary? What if in order to preserve balance, what Zed did had was actual... what if it was necessary? But Zed didn't do that, so... It's... No. I don't like this. And again, I want to stress, this is not a call-out. This is not like a, oh, the Odin Schaefer who wrote this, Odin Austin Schaefer is a bad writer or whatever. No, he's not. He's made some choices that I disagree with. And I can see why he made them. I think I can see what he was trying to do. But I don't like it. I don't like it, because it just... It was so strong. Up until issue 6, like, the first 5 issues were so strong from the writing, so strong on the characterization, and then this one thing just doesn't work for me. Anyway, I will say a lot about the said comic, but I will never say that I was bored reading it. And that's, like, outside of everything else, that's perhaps the greatest, compliment that I can give it, is I was never bored reading it. I was never not engaged. I was never not interested. And for all of my criticisms of the artwork, again, I want to stress, there's a lot of really good artwork in here. There's a lot of really good stuff. There's a lot of good expressions. There's a lot of good action scenes. There's a lot of good environmental shots. Like, I didn't even spend enough time complimenting all the detail that's put into a lot of the foliage a lot of the time. There's a lot of good stuff. I have a ton of criticisms, but I don't want this to be just like an, this is stupid and sucks kind of video, because that's not the point I'm trying to make. Just retcon this bit out of it. Just no evil Kusho shadow demon. No Zed trying to get Shen to figure out that his dad is alive. None of that. Just a man who has made choices and who stands by them instead, please. I would like that a lot more instead of this... Oh, he was a good guy all along stuff, because that's not interesting to me. Anyway, that's enough. I have done enough. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you have managed to enjoy it somehow, I would appreciate a like, especially given, good lord, how long this video is. If you've made it this far, like if you've made it this far into the goddamn video, you might as well leave a like. I mean, surely, like what do you have to lose at this point? Leave a like, maybe a comment, maybe subscribe to the channel, hit the bell icon, because that makes numbers go up on YouTube, and numbers going up is good because of algorithm stuff. No, I don't fully understand it either, but that's the way business works on this platform. If you want to support the channel more directly than just clicking on buttons, then you can click on some other buttons over on patreon.com, where you can sign up for a monthly whatever, if you want to. I also have a tip jar down in the description that you can use to give me a one-time tip, and I have a merchandise store as well, which you should be seeing on your screen right now, some of the stuff that's on there. If you want that, then, you know, go ahead and buy it, and then I get a little bit of, like, I get, like, $3 if you buy a mug, so that's nice. Outside of that, what else? Right. Even if you don't want to support me, which is completely okay, like, believe me, at the end of my videos, I do try to encourage people to, generally speaking, support the content that they love with anything that they can, whenever they can. And especially in times like these, where there's a global pandemic on, advertisers are pulling their advertising from online platforms left and right because, well, people are getting laid off, the economy is slowing down. All of that stuff filters into YouTubers' lives as well, where ad rates across the website are plummeting. It hasn't been that bad on my channel yet, but some people have lost as much as 30% of their ad revenue. Some people have lost as much as 50%. So if there's a YouTuber whose work you enjoy, whether or not it's me, whether it's someone else, please consider supporting them directly with anything you can, because in these times it matters so much more than you think. even like a $1 donation can literally be the same as thousands and even more thousands nowadays of views on a video in terms of the economic impact that it has. So there's that. Last thing I have to advertise is I have a second channel. I do Let's Plays over there. Currently, I'm uploading like episodes of a Final Fantasy VII Remake playthrough that it's already here on my channel here, but it's like 10-hour VODs. So if you want that in an episodic format, that's over there. I'm also doing a playthrough of Final Fantasy VIII and Majora's Mask. Those are going up on the channel every once in a while also. And might play some Ori and the Blind Forest on that channel on stream in the near future. You know, so there's that. So if you want that, then I encourage you to go over there and like and comment and subscribe and do all the same YouTube things I've already told you to do. Anyway, that's the end of it. I'm done. I have said the thing I wanted to say about the said comic. Let's get interested in seeing what comes next. Thank you very much for watching, and please remember to wash your hands.